Hello, everybody. Shall we get started? You see your chocolate? This is what every speaker gets when thank you for talking. I just decided that I need to lose weight. So you can tweet this. My handle is Lutz Finger. No, but meaning, like, seriously, this chocolate is up for you guys. So watch and listen carefully for the best questions, like the first questions. Everybody gets a chocolate. So we can pretty much go for about 10 questions, but we will do them at the end. You're here to learn about text mining and how we at LinkedIn doing this. I wrote a book about analyzing social media. It's published by O'Reilly. And I go, whatever you do when you write a book, you go through the country and you make book signing sessions. You promise this to your editor. And what I realized is a trend. The book was published in the beginning of the year, and there's more and more questions coming about sentiment, text mining. How do you do this? So you guys are pretty much in the middle, spot on, in the hype of technology. And we're trying to give you today a little bit like a flavor of how do you do this? What's underlying technology for this? And my colleague, we are both from LinkedIn. And let's first start like at the 10,000 feet view. Why are we doing this? Text mining, yeah, right? Our vision is to create economic opportunity. Now, how do we create economic opportunity for people? What does it even mean, economic opportunity? Well, we create economic opportunity, very simple, by understanding the CV, but as well understanding what you read and how you interact with those readings, understanding what's your skills, and mapping skills and expertise together. So LinkedIn is giving, on one side, an identity, on the other side, a network, and on the third side, a knowledge base. And if you think about it, we have 350 million members, and meaning we have, well, even more, but we have 350 million plus biographies, CVs, as well as a lot of interaction about those. Now, to understand those, we need text mining. Because already when somebody says, I'm a director, well, I'm a director, but if I were a director at a bank, then I'm probably just recently graduated. If I'm director at LinkedIn, it means something different. Okay, so we need to understand those nuances in text, and for this, we have a text mining platform. As well, so pretty much we're trying to structure text. As well, we have a lot of information inflowing to us. It's not only the stuff which you post, but other stuff which comes in. And what we at the moment use this platform for most of the times is to structure that data. So for example, this is a customer care ticket. People tell us online what the problem is, what they want to change, and so on and so forth. That's text. Now, a customer care agent works with it, but he's paid after speed. He definitely doesn't want to classify it. We have, as well, market research. So we go out and we ask people, what do you like about LinkedIn? What can we do better? And we have focus groups. Again, that's nice if you have one certain moment in time and the product manager is happy. But we continue doing this every day and every month. How do you get the big picture? How do you aggregate it? Let's keep it off for a second. And as well, we have people talking about us. So other networks are talking about us. Facebook, people talk about us. Twitter, people talk about us. So if we want to serve the vision which we are having of creating economic opportunity, we need actually to read all that stuff and somehow put it together to create good products, right? Now, if we only look at stuff which is inflowing in our system today. This is not like, you probably know that at LinkedIn you can publish and you have the possibility to use LinkedIn as a publishing platform. I'm not talking about this data. I'm only talking about the data I showed you earlier. People, customer care tickets, our brand awareness, or how people engage with us in market research. If I only look at this data, we're looking at over 10 million articles a year, right? Now, to read 10 million articles a year takes you roughly 23 years to read all that stuff, so don't expect me to act before 23 years. That ain't work. So we need a computer to put this to work. And here we go. That's what we introduced you today. We developed LinkedIn's text mining platform. Who of you guys has done text mining before. That's scarily little, because we're not the only one out doing it. I just have here a random selection of a couple of companies who offer services, free or as paid services, to do text mining. Because that idea of taking text data is around since quite a while. Any idea why in the public discussion, big data and data mining and all that stuff is up since 2011 latest? Yeah. Why hasn't text mining really surfaced? Why is it that I only see now the pattern of that people come more and ask me about text mining? Any reason? Come on, guys. I know it's after lunch, but any reason, I don't like trying to get you. It's difficult to do, which in reverse means other things are. Thanks. Other things are actually easier to do. And we see this very often, when did Google start with their text mining? Well, first, they kind of looked at the linkage. This is structured data. Structured data is easier. But over time, 2011, a lot of people go into this field trying to figure out things. It becomes more and more difficult to come up with innovation, to come up with cool stuff. So a lot of companies now turn to text mining and say, how can we do this? It's not a new field. You even can try this at home. Who of you have ever used R? Yeah, okay. It's more than text mining. My favorite package in R is TM. You can test it out. It has a lot of handy functions to do actually text mining. And a lot of those concepts you will learn today. So if you're not familiar with what's on that page, listen very closely. You will learn it. How to get rid of white space, how to remove stop words, do basic term frequencies. So, and you might scratch your head and say, hold on, this is totally nice. So I understand it that LinkedIn needs to aggregate text and kind of structure text in order to get their vision done. Cool. I understand it's nothing new, and I understand that it can be even done at home with R. So why in the world are these both guys coming and saying we build a text mining platform? Even more, we actually filed a patent for it. So why is that? Now, there's three things: size, security, and focus. If you have 350 million members and 10 million documents only about the brand LinkedIn, and more than 10 times what people publish on our platform, and so on and so forth, you have a scale problem. You, whatever we do internally, then, we say, this is nice, but how about on scale? So this is it. We have a scale problem, therefore we better design our system. Second thing is a security system. A lot of platforms who are out there say, we do an awesome job, give us the data. Well, I guess all of you are on LinkedIn, and you probably wouldn't, you gave us your data, you probably wouldn't like it that we give your data away to somebody else analyzing it. So there is, we are sensitive with this. This is our lifeblood. So a lot of companies who want to deal with our data, we pretty much can say, no, it doesn't work. It has to be on site. And then there's a limitation they offer. And the third thing is focus. Now, you will see this through the course of the discussion. Text mining, as this gentleman said here over, in the front, is inherently difficult. Why is that? Because we as human beings are inherently diverse, which is awesome, right? We like this as people. Computers don't like diversity. It would be very easy if they can classify things in 1, 2, 3 buckets. Humans have irony, sarcasm, a lot of nuances. Difficult to do. But if you know what you're looking for, if you have the focus, then you can actually achieve it. But you have to have that focus. So whenever you go and you will see a lot of text mining platforms who say I do sentiment for you. That's bullshit. Because they don't do sentiment for you. They have a generic sentiment algorithm. Now if you want to apply to yourself, then you have to have the focus, and then you actually need to get your hands dirty. Okay. There's three components to a text mining platform, and this is nothing new. Those three components are actually, you pretty much see them if you're looking at the platforms out there in the space, and guess what? That's as well our agenda. So we're talking today about how to do topic mining, like how to do topics. We talk about text classification, and about a couple of applications. With this one, over to you.
Can you guys hear me? Good. So we talk about topic mining. So the first question we want to ask is, what is a topic? How do you define a topic, right? So here, topic means something most important or most significant that can highlight the gist of your document. So giving a document, it can talk about something. It can also mention other things. So what is the focus? What is the very core that can represent this document? So here, topics are mined from the given document. It can be keywords or key phrases. And here, the topics are mined using natural language processing or any other statistical methods. Please note, they are not extracted from existing taxonomy or some kind of structured information with the tags, for example. So we do mining, but not matching to an existing kind of taxonomy. That's the difference. This diagram shows some top topics mined from poncho articles on LinkedIn.com. So we will see towards the end of the presentation as a use case or application to illustrate. So talking about topic mining, there are three main approaches to solving this problem. They are rule-based and statistical methods plus the NLP methods. We will go over each of these three main approaches in more detail. So first, the rule-based. So by rule-based, we mean we can create certain rules by intuition or heuristics to govern what kind of patterns can be used to extract the certain important things. So looking at this example, this is a document. Starts with the headline 2. Online shopping, and then simply just the one paragraph. So it's very straightforward. So what do you guys think the topic should be in this case? You made it. Oh, wow, nice guess. So next question is, why is online shopping the topic? I think we agree, right? Online shopping is definitely the most important topic for this document. Why is that? Anyone?
Yeah.
Three times. Awesome. Yeah. You made it. Okay. So, anything else? So, first of all, it appears as a headline, right? And it also appears at the beginning of this paragraph. And then it also appears somewhere in the paragraph with a bold text. Plus, it appears three times in total. So a lot of these signals can, you know, contribute to the final determination of what are the topics for this document, right? Very straightforward. So the question will be, how do we define such rules or patterns to extract these topics? Well, there are a lot of alternatives you can define such rules, but the two most popular ones are using HTML tags or end text or other rules like at the beginning of the document or paragraph, right? For example, we can list a large patterns where each HTML tag is given a particular weight. The weight, the more the better, for example, from 0 to 1, the more the better. It will highlight how important if such a tag exists. The text governed by that HTML tag should represent how important the candidate should be, right? And text, on the other hand, sometimes plays an important role as well, because people often using the core or the very simple compact tag, short piece of text to represent what's in the actual document. So if we apply these rules to the previous document, headline has 1.0 and beginning, like the bold text has 0.9. So even adding all this up will lead it to 2.8. So it's an easy win for online shopping. But if you apply all the other rules, you will also probably get eBay and Amazon or deals as topics. Those are less important for this case, but they are good candidates. So, as we have seen, rule-based is very straightforward and very easy to implement. The problem is, because you need to find out such rules by heuristics or intuitions, you never can complete the rule set, right? You will always find the new rules, or in some cases, the existing rule contradictory to the some new patterns. So we have to look at other options as well. Here comes statistical. So statistical is simply doing math, right? So we all know computers are stupid, but they are smart in the sense they will do an excellent job executing what you tell them to do, right? So if we have the right function or the right formula and ask the compute to calculate how often one candidate appears, or in how many documents they appear, such kind of things are perfect for computers to do. So looking at this example, here we have a document, and each shape represents, candidate word, right? A single word, basically. So the blue squares are the same word. So are the pink triangle, and a purple triangle, and a pink circle. So what do you think is the most important topic here? Which shape represents the topic for this document? Take a guess. Yeah, okay, I don't have enough chocolate, sorry. But you made it, yes, yeah. So I would think. Yeah, the blue square wins, right, easily. Now, let's take a more closer look. Now I have three documents, and in each document, the number of shapes appear a little bit different. So now let's ask the same question. In this document, first document, do you still think the blue square is most important? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, some say yes, some say no. Okay, so it's debatable, right? Why? Because imagine in the extreme, if you have 100 or even 1,000 documents, right? The blue square always appear multiple times in every single document. Then we have to think, maybe this is something like the article the or something, or preposition for, right? It could be stop words, something like that, right? So we have to be mindful, does this candidate appear everywhere? How frequent it is in the whole collection of documents? So here comes the most classical statistical method called a term frequency inverse document frequency. It is heavily used in search engine ranking functions, right? So the idea here is it prefers topics that appear frequently in one single given document, but the less frequently in the whole document corpus to take the balance, right? So here is the formula. It's also very straightforward, and it has multiple variations in terms of how do you calculate TF, which is the number of times you appear in one document. It can also have like a variation like a normalized term frequency based on the maximum frequency of any single word in the current document. The inverse document frequency is simply to penalize if you appear too frequently across the whole document corpus, you should be penalized, right? And so, I'm sorry. Oh, you have a question. Go ahead.
I just had a question about the documents. So are the, let's say those three documents, would those be coming from the same web page? Or how would you define the multiple documents?
It's simply multiple documents. Usually, these are the documents in a certain domain you are dealing with. Let's say you are looking at tweets for your company.
Yeah.
Let's say you have a million or half a million. So that half a million is the number of documents you have in this current corpus. Yeah. Yeah. In another example, if you want to find out hotel reviews, right? For your company, you want to deal with all the hotel reviews for that particular hotel or all the hotels you're looking
at. Because you said you have multiple instances within multiple pages, but if they're all related, let's say it was hotels, like you said, there's going to be a lot of instances for double treatment.
Sure, yeah. But usually it's per domain. Let's say you have hotel reviews plus vehicle reviews. Okay. Probably you want to separate them out. Yeah. Okay. So, let's say we have 128 such documents like this, that's the big N, right? And then for the current document, this guy, we have three blue square and two purple triangle. So the formula will be 3 times log of 2 base 2, 128 over 32, leading to 6. But for the purple triangle, it turns out to be 10. So in this case, the formula actually feels the purple triangle is more important than the blue square, right? So it depends. And this is the very classic statistical method.
Maybe to add to your question, the way you define the group of documents represents a certain assumption you put in. If you say I put all documents in about hotels, then guess what your normal, if you don't do the inverse one, will find? All those documents about hotels. Well, you knew that because there was your predefined setting.
Yeah.
So you're actually not interested on the obvious, you're interested for, okay, what else except hotels is in there? Oh, rooms. No, what else is in there? So you're looking actually for the non-standard one. If you say I look at everything worldwide, then you don't do this because of resources.
Yeah. Okay. So you might say, okay, TF idea, so what, right? So actually there are much more complex statistical methods like the latent Dirich allocation algorithm. And there are other topical modeling algorithm based on more sophisticated, advanced mathematics. Because of the scope of the talk and the time constraint, we don't want to cover all the statistical methods. We just use one to illustrate the idea. Our focus today will be the NLP based, which comes next. So NLP stands for natural language processing. As Lutz mentioned just a while back, we human beings understand the natural language, the diversity, the complexity. However, to train the machine to understand the large volume of text in different background, different context, and even different languages is a very, very challenging task. However, the the academia and the industry have made a lot of progress over the last 2 decades. There have been some stable natural language techniques which we can apply to real data, and if we combine them in the right way, they sometimes are very effective. Today we are going to show you some examples how we apply these NLP techniques. Okay, so speaking of natural language processing, and specifically for topic mining, our solution is a suite of natural language processing techniques spanning from part of speech tagging to part of speech pattern matching, all the way to topic pruning and eventually the topic ranking. So we will go over each individual component in detail in a second. So the first step is part of speech tagging. So we all understand, given a natural language sentence, we can find out the nouns, the verbs, pronouns using this technique, right? So why is this important? Because when you have the right tagging of a part of speeches, you can look for patterns. For example, a verb followed by a noun, or noun followed by a verb, or even more complex pattern, there will be modifiers in between, right? For example, I went to Washington Park yesterday. So this is tagged as a pronoun, a verb, preposition to, and a proper noun, and a regular noun, right? So very like straightforward. However, the back-end technique, part of speech tagging itself, is not trivial. There are two main approaches to in order to be able to accurately tag in each part of speech. You can do rule-based, where you have a huge corpus where people already manually tagged each individual word, which part of speech tag it should be. And then you can look for this corpus and define, you know, contextual and linguistic rules to have learned, trained rules. Later you can apply on new document or new sentence. The second method is more about a statistical. You're using advanced modeling like a hidden Markov model to learn a system which can predict the part of speech tag for any given sentence. Here we focus on English language only, but there are already like tagged corpus for foreign languages like German or Dutch. They are openly available. Our focus is to apply the best part of speech tagging to obtain the accurate pattern, right? So once you have the part of speech for every single sentence, what do you do? Previously we mentioned, once you have a part of speech, you want to define certain patterns. And the ultimate goal is to find out what is the most important topic, keywords or key phrases for the given document, right? So we observe that many most important topics are quite often the either entities, which are noun phrases like credit card, mobile app, right, or billing statement. These are the like very core entities you want to care about. As well as there are certain actions associated with your entities, such as close my account, pay my monthly bill, or you know, payment denied, which is a bad user experience, right? So these are the actions you want to catch in your data, in addition to the very important entities. Both kinds of topics, can be mined or governed by the part of speech tagging. So here comes what we want to highlight today. These are the patterns that will highlight what I just described to be able to find out what are the most important patterns or topics. And this is the first time we talk about in public, and this is a patent pending technique to extract topics using the natural language patterns, right? So we introduce, we have entities and we have events, right? For entities, once you have the part of speech sequence, you want to find out one or more. Basically, there could be no adjective before a noun. So you have a noun phrase, could be repeated, right? And you may have modifiers like adjectives. This is the very simplest noun phrase you can imagine. However, it will extract all the good candidates like credit payment, my homepage, my profile, or existing account, or old account. All those key concepts will be caught by this simple pattern, right? And then for the events, we have two different events. One is a noun phrase followed by a verb phrase. So these are different variations of the verb part of speech, like the past tense or present tense, right? So this pattern will give you all the noun plus verb pattern, like application crash. How often do you see such pattern exist in your, let's say, customer service tickets or some kind of a product survey, right? Also, like previous transaction failed or transaction succeeded, right? This kind of important events will be captured by your pattern, event topic, pattern one. The next one is called verb phrase followed by a noun phrase. It's the opposite. So typical examples like you want to accomplish certain kind of activity, like pull credit reports or close account or merge account or delete account, right? Or add a new membership, right? Subscription. So all these three patterns are the very secret sauce for this NLP approach. However, in addition to this secret sauce, we have quite a few key NLP techniques to make this pipeline complete and reliable in terms of both performance and quality. So with the secret sauce, you are able to create or capture all the important event entities and the events. But the downside is you may also introduce some noise, right? These are the candidate topics that satisfy your natural language processing pattern. However, they may not be that meaningful. Like, for example, in the customer service domain, you may very often see, thank you, or contact us, right? These kind of topics, they satisfy your rules or patterns, however you want to remove them, right? So we have three techniques, from stemming to removing stop words to synonym matching, to make sure the candidate topics extracted can be systematically pruned, so you have a very concrete, the real valuable topic list. So the very first pruning technique is called stemming, which is a process to find the water stem of multiple variations. For example, considering these two words, engineering and engineer, they have the same stem, engine. Or in another example, profile and profiled, they have the same stem, profile. And the view, viewed has have the same stem, view, right? So the reason here we do stemming is to merge all the possible variations with the same stem together as one single entity or one representation. But which variation should you choose? Often you look at all the variations that share the same stem sequence, and for every single word, you look at which stem appears most often, and then you choose that individual word as the representative. So in this case, out of these three words, view appeared twice versus viewed only once, profile and profiles twice versus once. So you choose view profile as the representative words for all variations that share the same stem sequence, right? So this is actually very simple but very powerful. The second technique is back to the statistical method. You have a lot of blue squares everywhere, right? But if it appears every single document, it might be a stop word. So stop word is something that appears too often in every single document and it has less value. For example, articles, propositions, and these words appear so often everywhere and you want to simply remove them. So there are standard stop words, like a few hundred. You can easily remove them. And as I just mentioned in the customer service domain, you may have a specific domain-specific stop words, like a thank you, or contact us, or email back, or submit a ticket. Those will be domain-specific, and you have to spend some time to manually create that list. But as you go, you can start with nothing. And as you go, you look at some of the top topics. If you feel they actually should be included in your domain-specific stop words, you can easily add them back, right? So this will be very useful. The last pruning technique is called a synonym matching. So the goal is to merge all the semantic related topics in one bucket. It's kind of similar to the document clustering or object clustering. You try to group them together. All the entities inside the one bucket will be kind of equivalent in the semantics, right? For example, here, main profile, main account, primary account. In a premium membership context, they mean the same thing. They can be put together. So if you have these three as separate topics, you can actually just merge them and use whichever the most popular as the representative of your cluster. Right? Same here, gain access, obtain access, or get access. They are the same thing. Delete account, close account, right? So you might be asking, how do you generate this? How do you know they are equivalent? Well, there are at least two approaches. One is using a dictionary, like a WordNet, okay, which is an open source project, looking at the English dictionary, and it also lists all the synonyms, antonyms, all the variations of the every single word. So you can use synonym segment of the WordNet to help you build this kind of synonym corpus. The other approach is you might use more advanced technique like a co-occurrence. if two words, they try to appear together in a certain window across majority of your documents, there is a very good chance they are semantically related and could be grouped. So there are at least these two popular techniques you can apply to create your synonym corpus. And keep in mind, these synonyms are usually domain dependent. For example, small in the camera domain, let's say, okay, the screen size is too small, might be, you know, kind of negative, right? But on the other hand, if the cell phone is small enough to be carried in my pocket, it might mean, you know, the good thing. So in the later chapter, we talk about sentiment analysis. It's the same thing. This is a domain dependent, so just to keep in mind. So now we've talked about part of speech tagging and part of speech pattern matching and topical pruning. So by far, you should have a very good list of candidate topics. Still, let's say if you want to just have, you know, top 10, top 50, top 100, top 200, how do you know which ones? Imagine you have 1,000 out of the MLP pipeline, right? Still, you have to rank them. So there are many techniques you can rank them. And in our approach, we looked at the term frequency inverse document frequency approach. So for every single document, we calculated the TF-IDF score for every candidate topic by last step. And then we keep up to 10 topics for every single document. Now keep in mind the TF-IDF only gives you topics per document, not the whole document collection, right? If our goal is to mine what are most important topics for the whole document corpus, you still have an additional step to pick which ones can represent the whole document collection. Here we're using the document frequency. Because we have done all the natural language processing, matching, filtering, pruning, by this far we should not see things like a stop words. So document frequency is actually very safe to use at this step. So I want to show you some examples of the verbatims we are dealing with. I won't read everything, but for example, in MPS surveys, we quite often see feedback or suggestion like this. The layout could be improved, okay? There is a lot of stuff I don't need to see on each page. And in the app reviews, let's say interface has gotten better over time, but still not as easy as I'd like. And here, a typical example, I withdraw a request to close account. So in this single sentence, we will find two topics. One is a withdraw request. The other one is a close account. This is very important for our business. First of all, we can identify that some member wants to close account. Why? Right? Secondly, the member changed his mind. He initially submitted this request, but now he wants to withdraw. What made the retention work, right? How come the member changed the mind, right? So there are a lot of interesting scenarios you should look into your member behavior, and you are able to mine such issues and improve your products and experience. So that's why topical mining is so important and so useful in your day-to-day operations and delivering new products and experience. So that's just a few examples of the verbatim, how they look like. Here is a rough distribution of the three data sets we are looking at. So majority of our ticket data is customer service emails. we do have quite a big volume of survey data and some app reviews for the LinkedIn mobile apps. So here are some sample topics, top topics extracted out of the pipeline on each data set. So in the NPS surveys, we actually find these are the top entity topics, like professional connections, social networking, business opportunity, job posting, mobile apps. At least professional connection, social networking, business opportunity, job posting. So those four kind of highlight what is a LinkedIn business, what is the advantage members or benefits members will get by joining LinkedIn, right? And here on the actions or events associated with this, you can find the jobs, make a connections, you know, build your network, and you know, share ideas in the forum or discussions. So these are very cool topics you want to find out and you know, keep on your hand, right? In the app review domain, it's the same story. You have iPhone app, Android, update, black screen. No, this is bad, right? Because if the app crashes, keep crashing, it's really bad for the users, right? So here, you see what kind of activities our members have engaged with our mobile apps, right? They reinstall, they try to access the account from mobile app, and they read articles and all kinds of key activities. In the customer service scenario, you have a profile, password, premium subscription, and a company page. The events here are like a send an invitation, update a profile. So those are all like very important activities in our business domain, right? So the next question we want to ask is, cool, you have all these good topics, but how do you judge the quality? Do you feel it's good enough, or there is still room for improvement, right? So we need an objective judgment or fair metric. So typically we have two different approaches towards topic mining evaluation. If you have a good standard or ground truth, let's say for every document you already manually identify what are the topics should be, then you can compare your machine generated topics with the human defined topics, right? So those are the actual topics and the predicted topics. You do the both. So precision will measure out of the machine generated topics, the ratio of those topics are actually also human labeled. Okay, so the ratio of extracted topics that are truly topics. And the recall measures the coverage, meaning out of all the actual topics, how much is captured by the machine. So you have two different angles, right? One is accuracy, the other one is coverage. You often need a balance of the two using the F1 measure. However, in certain applications, you may sacrifice the other measure, but dream for one particular, let's say precision. So the second approach is, in many other cases, you don't have this good standard because it's very expensive to create topics for every single document. Imagine you have 10 million, what do you do, right? So in that case, you can use crowdsourcing, but the problem is in crowdsourcing, you have to do an awesome job of training the human subjects to understand the guideline, to do a solid job to control the quality of their labeling, right? So those are the two issues with crowdsourcing. But it's an option. And you can start with a small scale. It works. And if you want to expand to a large scale, often the issues come out, right? And so now, assume you don't have the good standard. What do you do? In this case, there are also solutions. You can judge the quality in performing a particular task. For example, you measure how useful or how helpful each individual topic is by, let's say, thumbs up or thumbs down. Or even go to a more fine-grained scale. Let's say you rate each topic in the current task from 1 to 5. And then you can aggregate these statistics easily. One particular measure people often use is called the acceptable percentage, which is counting the ratio of topics that receive a score of at least 3, or even more, right? The more the better. So for our data sets, the 3 big data sets, we look at the top 10, top 20, top 50, and the top 100. What is the acceptable percentage for each list? In general, we see similar pattern. So as you increase the number of topics, if you want to keep more, apparently there will be more noise. It's never perfect, right? So if you look at like a top 20, in general, you still have 0.7, 0.8, meaning 80% of your topics is useful. So here, we want to present this as kind of, baseline or benchmark. In the future, we want to compare our pipeline with the very classical method, the TF-IDF, and the more advanced popular method like LDA. How do our NLP suite compare with other conventional methods? So topic mining, by far, we have talked about, the rule-based approach, statistical approach, and NLP. Our focus is the NLP pipeline, right? As you have seen. But in general, when you develop any kind of topic mining method, you have to think about 3 things. First of all, apparently it's a quality. How good are the mined topics, right? Do you carry a lot of noise, or do you still have to do, further pruning and all kinds of cleaning stuff? The second one is the scalability. How scalable is your algorithm or your system? Today, we have millions of data points or text documents per day. How do you scale your algorithm? That's why, the good statistical method like LDA, it's quite often not that straightforward to scale to deal with millions of documents in a very short time, right? Even you apply this kind of advanced method into Hadoop, it's not very trivial. But our NLP approach is scalable. You can use each individual component can be implemented in the MapReduce environment. So it's very powerful to deal with large volume of data. And the third factor you should think of is, as we mentioned, different domains and different languages, right? Especially foreign languages nowadays, when you are having a global business, your customs are across the globe, right? They tend to use their local languages. How do you, handle or care about their experience and their feedback, right? So this is very important. And that's for the topic mining component. The second bigger component for our talk today is called the text classification. Now, text classification, as you all can imagine, is basically given a document, you try to predict what kind of metadata it belongs to, right? For example, you have, let's say you have 10 top products, and you have a whole bunch of documents. You want to understand for each document which one or more products it belongs to. Does it mention your mobile app, or your email program, or your advertising platform, right? You have to segment those products. So that's text classification. Basically, you throw a whole bunch of training examples into the machine. The machine will produce a model for you, and then later you can use the model to predict the new data. So let's use sentiment analysis as one example, right? I have a whole bunch of documents. I want to understand how happy my customers are. Are they positive with this particular product? Or they are neutral, or they are totally negative, right? This is any kind of text analytics platform should carry, right, the function. And at the verbatim level, you have to be very accurate. So first of all, we use the to represent each individual document. So this can be unigrams or bigrams. And once you have the features, you could have, because by English vocabulary, you can easily have 1 million, right? Or even more when you consider bigram and trigram. So how do you pick the ones that are truly informative or meaningful or discriminative across different buckets, right? So here comes the topic, the feature selection method. So you have, you know, all popular statistical methods. However, we found our NLP pipeline is very effective in selecting the good text-based features, like a great place, build a network connection. And once you have the very solid feature set, you represent each document using the term, using the document term matrix. And the weighting here is, can be binary, or even using the normalized frequency, or even TF-IDF. So once you have the documents represented by these vectors, you can throw into the machine. You can use any fancy learning algorithm, naive Bayes, random forest, support vector machine, you name it, right? So I will illustrate two very simple, two examples, not very simple. Naive Bayes is basically based on the naive Bayes theorem. You predict the class of a new document based on the likelihood and the prior probability. Here, this predicted prior probability is a fixed for any given document. So you only care about the topo, right? And there is an independence assumption, meaning we assume all the features are independent to each other. So this can be transformed to this guy. And now you're able to calculate the probability of each individual feature given by the current class. So then you calculate this for every single class and you pick the maximum that can be predicted as the class for your document. And the support vector machine is by far the best algorithm in text classification. The core idea is you have a whole bunch of objects. You want to separate them into different classes. Here we use a binary case, right? You want to find one hyperplane that separates these two groups, square and the triangle. So you have many options, like this guy or this guy. However, the goal is to find the one hyperplane which can maximize the margin between these two groups. That's a support vector machine. And in real applications, it's been proved to be the best one in many cases so far. So once you have, you know, classification, you also have to do evaluation. You can use a cross-validation to test the quality of your data set, meaning you split them into even folds. Every time you leave one fold aside, use the other folds for training, and the test on the one left aside, and you average over all the folds, right? The other option is you have some training data, some testing data, you do cross-validation on the training data only, and eventually you apply the best classifier on the testing part to see how good the precision recall and the F1 is, right? So, I have to warn you guys, as I mentioned already, sometimes the features are domain dependent, like the small case, right? In camera versus a cell phone, right? In the sentiment scenario, if somebody say go watch the movie, it's also context dependent. In one case, it could be, you know, for that particular movie, it's very good, right? And imagine there is also a book for this movie. That could be a bad signal for the book, right? Because you are encouraged to watch the movie. So I hope you guys have enjoyed what we presented so far. Next, Lutz will showcase some real applications based on our technique.
Okay, 60 minutes down. We kind of went through a lot of stuff. How are you doing so far? Okay. It's now all the applications are very much dependent on your business case. It is not one single one, you know? Like, people might say, oh, I use text mining to suppress spam. Other people might say, oh, I use text mining to analyze sentiment, and so on and so forth. So pretty much we talked about the sentiment one, and all the good things you saw, like we cut it down in structure, we apply our secret source to it, before we actually cut it into structure, we use stemming, pruning, remove stoppers, structure. Then we go and identify with the secret sauce those topics. And then we take for each topic all the sentiment sentences we have. And then we do sentiment. Why is this important? Because we have seen a lot of companies doing sentiment only going over the whole document. Now, if you read an article, it's actually the job of the journalist is to start low, mid, high, and low, or vice versa. Like, he has some modulation in it. And customer care tickets are no any different. It's only less beautiful written. So people say, I really like this, but that's so shitty. And what do you do? if you take one clause, you can't do this. So, well, you take stop words out, you do all that beautiful stuff which we learned, and then you say, oh, there are two subjects in. I really like this is one subject, but that is so shitty is the other subject. I won't tell you. Nothing is shitty in our world, obviously. So you kind of group those together, and then you look at what are people normally about this, what are they saying? You do the aggregated sentiment, and that gives you actually a pretty good idea about this normally people say. Now suddenly you have, and this is what I'm saying about focus, you have for your specific topic, for your specific attributes, you have sentiment. And then obviously you need to visualize it because otherwise business people won't talk to you. And you like surface what's happening. So here's a visualization. Well, it's beautiful, isn't it? Anyhow, I didn't show it. Like, in reality, we do this by product in order to understand what's happening around the product. What are people saying? Now here we took a different sample size, like a different source, but more or less, you know, people talk about professional
profile, please see that it's a log scale. You see that a lot of positive sentiment around the term professional profile. Not very surprising, we are a professional network, right? You have the negatives, you have the neutral. Neutral is actually more than negative in this case. And you have the unknown.
As Tiger showed, if you do machine learning, well, you have this area in between where it's not totally sure, is it now positive or is negative, the machine can't find a clue, can't make it up, didn't have a test case for it, then it becomes neutral, or like unknown.
You have something like people want to change industry.
Well, that's very often like, you know, when people discuss about LinkedIn, they're saying it's an awesome network because I can actually learn about an industry and I can change to a different industry and so on and so forth.
So, again, positive. And I tried to put not in examples where people complain about us.
They don't. No, but you get the idea. Try to make it usable for your use case. How do you do this? Well, talk to your business partners and figure that out. What is it actually what they can do? Let's go on. Second application, which I'm giving to you, is trending content. Well, trending content, that's kind of like an awesome buzzword, right? It's the up since like first trending content tool I saw in my life was I think 2005, 2004 we started with social, right? Again, trending content can be very subjective in order, what do we need to do? Well, LinkedIn is an awesome platform for people to publish advertisements, sponsored content. Why is it awesome? Because we know so much about the people who are actually clicking on it. We actually have a way better understanding for professional content. What are people looking for? Now, if you want to understand, if you are a publisher, like somebody who promotes content, you want to understand what's actually out there. What's trending so that I can go to it. We at LinkedIn, we always say it's reach. You need to have reach. You need to have frequency. You need to have content in order to create engagement, whatever that is, right? So it's very important which content. Now, if you have, again, those 23 years to read, then afterwards you knew what content was trending at that time, if you can remember. But so we take all the news articles, we define a segment. What's a segment? A segment is for people who will read those news articles. What are CXOs reading? What are CMOs reading? What are actually people reading in America? What are actually people who are CMOs in the tech industry reading in America? What are they looking at? Now, this is what we can now do. We kind of break it down. We can, or we say, what are all the people who are one of, I told you we're in a publishing platform as well. So Richard Branson is one of our so-called influencers. What's an influencer? In LinkedIn terms, it's just a guy we selected, Richard, and told him, listen, publish here and we promote you out. So he writes a lot of articles. Now the question he has, what do my followers read? He has a couple of followers, quite a lot. So we easily can cut down by the followers and say, all those followers, these are topics which are of interest for your followers. Meaning, again, we cut down to articles, now we determine from who of those followers gets engaged. We look for the topic, so we do the topic mining and we visualize it. Always the same thing. Take text, cut it, aggregate it, visualize it. Totally simple. What's problem is you always need to figure out for who do you do this. This is again the focus part. Now how does this look in the visualization? Here, for example, United States, segment of CXOs. Now this is all trending in CXOs. I select the venture capital. Here are the articles. Now, if I want to appeal to
CXOs in venture capital or venture capital area in the United States, I know what these guys read. I know what I can publish to them.
So to be helpful for them, to create economic opportunity, because these guys are obviously looking for something.
Now, same thing we can do if we look for audience. Here is actually, we say again, United States. I look at who is actually interested in technology, software, internet, and then I see like the seniority, the industry, and as well the audience segments. All no rocket science, right?
It comes down to take text,
structured. A lot of those tools are out there available. Think about scale. Think about how you mix it up and then display it.